Tom Libous reports to you. Fighting to keep state spending under control. Exploring new options for economic growth and jobs for our communities. Helping our kids succeed by encouraging them to read and stay away from drugs and alcohol. Welcome to Tom Libous Reports to You. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, Senator Tom Libous and I are going to talk about measures to protect your family safety and local businesses. How are you?
Good. A lot going on. Busy time.
Yes.
You know, going through the budget hearings, we're passing legislation.
Yeah, I want to talk about this this crime legislation that seems to be, there seems to be a lot of crime bills passing. The Senate passed a bill that would expand the DNA evidence, the amount of DNA evidence that the state would be able to work with to solve crimes. So give us some insight into what kind of tool a DNA data bank is.
Well, we set up a DNA data bank, I think in 1994. I actually voted for the legislation to establish it, and that allowed law enforcement agencies through DNA to be able to track individuals who may have repeated different types of crimes, assaults, and what have you. What we just did recently is gone a little bit further. We expanded it so that all felonies would be included, and that every penal law misdemeanor would be included. What that means, it pretty much doubles those individuals that are going to have to be actually put into the DNA data bank. Why is that important? We're finding that many low-level crimes turn into serious felonies, assaults. We think that the expansion of the DNA database is going to protect families, women, children, and it's going to help us to go after those criminals that that create problems and assault people in our society.
Right, and a lot of people have problems with the privacy aspect of it, but there really hasn't been any infringements since this has been enacted.
No, Julia, they really haven't. You know, when fingerprinting first came on the scene, you know, that was a great opportunity many, many years ago to take your fingerprint and to track an individual. This DNA evidence and expanding the database is really modern day fingerprinting. It's 21st century fingerprinting. It's the new technology and how to track criminals, how to go after them, how to make sure you know, we can stay on top of their whereabouts. It's a great program. We need it to pass the Assembly. It's passed the Senate. We're very supportive of it. The governor says he supports it. Mm-hmm. He actually came out publicly and said that the Senate's DNA expansion is a good bill, and it should pass the legislature, and he would sign it if it got to him.
Right. I believe he put that in his budget bill, right?
He did. So he was very pleased that we took the initiative and actually passed it, and that's something that we now need the Assembly to move forward, or if not, maybe we put it all in the budget and when we get to our final negotiations over the course of the next several weeks.
Right. The Senate Republicans have really been working towards a lot of this with Megan's Law, which is requiring the sex criminals to put their to be identified online, and e-stop, where they cannot prey on
That's right.
individuals online.
You know, we have been very successful in the Senate. We have been a leader in this state when it comes to predators on women and children and individuals, and certainly Megan's Law was passed a number of years ago to go over the look at those pedophiles who are assaulting and in some case murdering our children. That has been extremely successful. They can be tracked. We know when they're living in our communities. This DNA data bank expansion is a crime fighter. It's that simple. It's going to help law enforcement agencies. We've had, you know, district attorneys have supported it throughout the state. Law enforcement has supported it. It's a good tool. I'm very proud to have voted for the bill and moved it forward.
Right. You know, it's important to amend laws and close loopholes to keep up with the times. And, you know, this is to protect New York families from criminal acts. But another measure that we talked about the last time you were here, public protection measure that you're really working on, is to protect families from natural disaster, from a natural disaster standpoint, too. But I want to move on to another criminal bill. Some people accidentally form habits from pain relievers that they may be prescribed. And, you know, it's out of control right now how many people are dying from overdoses. So the Senate's taking action to make sure that anyone involved in this surreptitious behavior of providing this stuff for the black market are going to face the consequences. So tell us about it.
Well, first off, we have found that there have been a lot of abuses of prescription drugs. We're seeing it all over the country. We're seeing that people are abusing, and there's always deaths of stars. It's inconclusive yet, but with the death of Whitney Houston, there's some suspicion that prescription drugs were involved. We don't know that yet until it's an autopsy, and certainly there's a conclusive report. Having said that, we do know that drugs are being stolen from pharmacies, that many physicians are, readily giving these drugs out, and they get used not as as a real painkiller to take care of a physical ailment, but they're used to pass on, to be sold to people who have an addiction to these types of drugs. They're serious. They're serious painkillers. We're now passing legislation that's going to tighten up the dispensing of these drugs. It's going to make it a criminal offense if these drugs get into the wrong hands, and certainly all of our pharmacists are good people, but at the same time, we want to make sure that there's not an easy access to some of these drugs, either through the physician or the pharmacy.
Right. Right now, I believe it's against the law for physicians, but you want to make it equal for pharmacists.
We want to make it equal for pharmacists. It's a serious issue. It's something that has to be stopped, and it's not just an adult issue. We hear about movie stars, whatever. Kids are getting access to these drugs, these painkillers. It's very serious stuff, and there are people who are just addicted to them, and they'll do whatever they can to have to try to fulfill their addiction. It's serious.
Right, and it's scary. You mentioned kids. When kids are doing other drugs like marijuana or cocaine, oftentimes you can see that in their face. You can see that in their actions. But a prescription drug is a little bit more secretive.
It is secretive, and we're getting feedback from emergency rooms where they're saying that 40% of the problems or issues that come to an emergency room that are not, from an accident or some sort of direct illness or sickness, is because of a drug overdose. And many times it's not, it's not heroin or cocaine. It's a prescription drug overdose. It's a prescription drug issue. The abuse of these narcotics is very serious, and we have to begin the process of looking at it seriously, and that's what this legislation does.
Yes, the addiction and selling on the black market, but it's also, you see, in the news, you see people going into pharmacies and shooting up drugstores.
It's wild. It's wild. No, thank God in the Southern Tier we don't have those issues, and I hope we never have those issues. But you do have them in the urban core. You have them in the bigger cities. New York, Philadelphia, Los Angeles, some of those cities. It's frightening because they are addicted, and when someone has an addiction, they'll do anything to get whatever they need to feel better, or what they think is making them feel better, but it's really not.
Very scary stuff. So another loophole closed.
Yeah.
So the Senate also passed a package of bills that would crack down harder on impaired or reckless drivers. So let's talk about the criminal act of texting while driving.
It's a serious thing. It's a very serious thing. We cracked down on it. We've passed legislation to make it a criminal act. Texting is something that we shouldn't be doing. And I don't care who you are. Every once in a while, you tend to pick up your phone while you're driving and you take a quick look at it. It's not a good thing to do. None of us should be doing it. At one time, there was a concern about just talking on your cell phone. Now it's texting. There are statistics that show that a good percentage of the accidents that take place now in our country are from distractions, of which texting on the cell phone is a major distraction. And it's not just young people. Young people probably are more prevalent to the accidents that take place, but there are adults that are doing the same. So we all have to do better at that. And we're making it a criminal offense. We're making it serious because in most cases where there are serious accidents, we find out that there was texting or distraction with a phone involved, and that's not a good thing.
Yeah, and a lot of kids like to use their phones, and they're already inexperienced drivers as it is.
Well, that's the other issue. you and I have been driving for a number of years, but still, you get that experience. But if you're distracted and you do something that you're going to send a message to somebody, or it's just not, you don't do it. It's that simple. Yeah. I can't be that more matter of fact about it. Whether you're an adult or a young person, just don't do it. Texting while driving is not a good thing.
Right, and it is being enforced because Governor Cuomo said that almost 119,000 motorists have been ticketed using handheld devices.
Yeah, you know, the governor's very serious about this too, Julia, like we are, and we're telling people that we've enforced the texting while driving law. It's something that has passed in this state a couple of years ago, and we're going after individuals. We want to, you need to protect your life and the life of others for the most part. So we're telling people that we are enforcing this law. The governor's serious about it. We're serious about it. And there are arrests that are taking place or tickets that are being issued.
Right. So now on to the economy and creating jobs, because I've often heard you talk about how imperative it is to help small businesses by cutting red tape and bureaucracy. So the next bill I want to talk to you about is a big issue for the business community, and it would repeal the annual pay notice mandate.
This is a complicated issue. Unless you're a business, you understand it. Probably right. People listening would not understand, but a couple of years ago, the legislature passed a bill that basically would require written notice on wages be provided by all private sector employees to the New York State Department of Labor over a six-year period. That's a mandate. That's unnecessary. I voted against it when it came up on the floor. Now I want to repeal it. I'm working with Senator DeFrancisco to repeal this unfunded mandate. Every business person, small business person in New York State throughout my district has said to me, Tom, this is ridiculous. I agree with them. That's why I voted against it when it came up the first time. Now we're going to work to repeal it because it's just more administrative costs that they have to do. Every small business does not have the time to take this information over a six-year period and provide it to the state. It's just, it's a nuisance. They're not going to do it. I'm going to work very hard to get this repealed.
Great, and that is the Wage Theft Prevention Act.
It is, and it's you just mentioned it to small business. They know what it is, and unanimously, I'm going to support them and get this thing repealed. That's why I voted against it in the first place.
And you're hearing about it, right?
Oh, we're all hearing about it. It's a bad piece of legislation.
Right. How are the businesses recovering from the flood devastation in the summer?
We're doing okay. It's a slow process. We still have businesses that are applying for the grants, and if you're a business and if you're not aware of it, you can apply for up to $20,000. Go on tomlibous.com. There'll be a link there. You can fill the application out. It takes you right to Empire State Development. If you're a business that was hurt by the flood, there's an opportunity for you to earn, or not to earn, but to get up to $20,000 in grants for floods. Businesses are coming back, Julia. They're doing better. There's still some that have lost all of their inventory. It's really the small businesses that are hurting here, and that's what we're trying to help. But I was in Owego the other day. It looks good. It's coming back. I was in Nichols and Cander area. It looks good. Binghamton is coming back. You know, it's all coming around, but I'll tell you what, people took an awful hit, and it's costing a lot of people a lot of money.
Right, and you're being proactive this year, trying to think of different ways to make sure families are safe and businesses are safe.
Well, we want to do the right things to protect our citizens, and at the same time, we want to make sure that business doesn't have the burden of government so that they can function and employ people, because we need jobs and job opportunities.
Right, and on tomlibous.com, you can find a lot of really great information.
Everything. Tomlibous.com is the place to go. Anything about state government, anything about information about the flood.
Right. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator. Thanks for watching Tom Libous Reports to you. For any additional information, you can log on to tomlibous.com.